Good afternoon to you. Mark Sutter with HurricaneTrack.com here with your hurricane outlook and discussion. It's now Wednesday, the 23rd of June, 2021, and you would think that it's maybe the second or third week of August with what we're going to be talking about today. That is right. It is not hyperbole. It's not hype. It is actually happening. I guess that's where that word hype comes from, hyperbole. I just thought of that. It's true, though. There's a lot to talk about, and it's only the latter part of June instead of the latter part of August when we would typically see things starting to get active. Now, there's nothing to worry about yet, so I'm going to put your mind at ease, but there are some signs that we need to be paying attention to going forward because they could be signs of a very busy season ahead, and we want to make sure that people are aware and have the right information in front of them and information that is actionable, something that they can make use of to help make informed decisions. So let's get on with it. As you can see there, the graphic, the thumbnail, the background graphic, the title card, whatever you want to call it. Busy week in the Eastern Pacific, absolutely some Atlantic stuff, including what is an Atlantic Niño? Well, we'll talk about that too. First of all, in the Atlantic Basin on the two-day graphical tropical weather outlook, I'll draw your attention down here to the bottom where I'm drawing this in yellow, 48 hours out. We have this one area down here with only a 10% chance of further development, but don't think of this as, oh, it's not going to develop into anything, so don't worry about it. No, that's not the way to look at this. Look at this as a piece of energy coming through here, a weak area of low pressure associated with a tropical wave. It will be moving generally off to the west and west-northwest, and it'll move across these islands over here. And that's where people live, and that could cause some problems. We'll show you that more in just a moment. But first, let's expand this to the next few days beyond the two-day time frame. Tack on 72 more hours. Now we're out to 5 days. And here is another area. I've been talking about this a little bit on my morning podcast. I've mentioned it on our Patreon site. And here it is. The ensembles have been picking up, especially the ECMWF. The development of a strong African wave, and wow, that would be really, really early to be seeing something like that. So we'll talk about that as well going forward. And we got to talk about this, a new system developing here in the Eastern Pacific. It will bring impacts, it looks like, to Mexico. So you folks there in southern Mexico, be ready. Heavy rainfall, some coastal impacts, high waves, onshore flow there, heavy rain, mudslides, you name it. Tropical cyclone time. I think last year almost everything that developed out here stayed away from Mexico, so we didn't have too much in the way of impacts. Nothing terrible this year, nothing you can't handle, but it's a different type of pattern, and these systems are inching closer to Mexico with their development than we saw last year. And as I've said before, honestly, at this point, it would be nice to get one to develop and come up the Gulf of California and at least bring some tropical moisture into the desert southwest where conditions are just really, really bad. This ongoing drought, the extreme temperatures as of late. We need some monsoon action or some tropical cyclone action. Just not too much at once, right? We got to be careful what you wish for. What is this? Well, this is 1933, going way back to 1933, the Trinidad hurricane, as it's called, among other names. You know, back then we didn't officially give these systems names, but this is the track from the best guess. You know, we didn't have satellites back in 1933, but we had plenty of ships and we had aircraft data, you know, just scattered around the basin. And so this is the best guess from scientists over the years. I mean, 1933 wasn't that long ago, come on. But long enough that, you know, this is not exactly right, probably. So, nevertheless, what is it? Why am I showing you this? Well, this is, from what I can tell, the earliest development at the end of June. This would be representing, let's use white so it pops a little better. That right there represents June 24th, I believe, when this thing got started. And it eventually became a hurricane, moved its way through the Southeast Caribbean, impacting Trinidad and Tobago. Trinidad with a direct hit, kind of scraping the northeastern part of South America, cutting it pretty close to Aruba, Bonaire, Curacao, and then coming up here into the Northwest Caribbean. And you got to imagine, must have been a pretty big heat dome sitting over the midsection of the United States to force this southwest. You usually don't see that, but that's what would have caused that, is a big area of high pressure more than likely set up and shoved this into Mexico. Why am I showing you this? Well, because we might, I got to emphasize it, might break this record, so to speak, for earliest development this far east, and I'll show you why in just a moment. So we'll have to reference this later. I'll save this graphic, and we might be pulling it up at a later time to see where things go. All right, so what's going on out there? Well, it's getting kind of busy. It's still just late June, yet we have quite a few things to watch. Here's the system in the eastern Pacific. There's the tropical wave flaring up just a little bit east of the islands. Yes, there are strong upper-level winds cutting across all through this region, and there's definitely a dry Saharan air layer out here. All of that being said, and all of those negatives in place, yet we still have this system down here, a strong easterly wave flaring up with showers and thunderstorms, and this is going to move through the islands here, and you know specifically which island gets impacted, impossible to tell this early. I mean, it's still a couple of days away, but you can bet very strong winds from time to time, and those thunderstorms, you get rain-cooled air. That air is heavy. It sinks. It spreads out. You get what's called a downdraft, and just the gusty winds of the whole thing passing through there, that easterly wave, the wind shift, it can capsize boats. It can knock over cabanas and umbrellas and other beach things. I'm serious. This is a problem. If people aren't aware, they'd be like, where'd this come from? Well, that's where it's coming from. It's coming from your east. And it can bring very heavy rainfall. And with the elevated terrain down there on some of these islands, and remember I talked about it yesterday, they are not flat. It's not like those desert island, you know, that you see in movies and cartoons and whatever. Some islands, especially in the Pacific, are like that. Maybe the atolls. But down in the Caribbean, these are volcanic islands, most of them. And so they have elevation, and that can cause some flash flooding when you put too much rain on them all at once. So from the U.S., British, Virgin Islands down through the Windwards and Leewards, everybody pay attention as this system moves through. Again, it doesn't take a hurricane. You know, we talk about that often, and that's the thing that most people, I guess, get amped up about. But it could just be a tropical wave that can bring a lot of problems. All right, speaking of tropical waves, that is a doozy. Getting ready to come off the coast of Africa, we are seeing some anomalous westerly winds coming out onshore here at about the 5,000-foot level as this sort of shift in the wind pattern, the western West African monsoon sets up. And then you've got the easterly waves coming this way, and that induces this spin in the atmosphere. It helps to get things going when you get that low-level westerly flow down in the lower levels of the atmosphere at about 850 millibars or so, 5,000 feet. And the water temperatures out here are quite a bit warmer than they should be. I'll show you that in just a moment. So real quick, the vorticity signature of our different features out here. There's the tropical wave east of the islands. This is the system south of the Gulf of Tehuantepec here. And this will go on to develop and move its way up towards Mexico. We'll look at the GFS forecast for that in just a moment. Elsewhere, though, really not much going on in terms of vorticity signatures. We're going to really watch this area in the next couple of days as this system moves into the frame. Yes, I know that there are charts farther east, but for the sake of continuity, I'll keep it on the Western Atlantic Basin shot. And that's most of the basin. I mean, there's the Cabo Verde Islands. But give it a couple of days, and this will move into the frame. Notice the cold front that just moved offshore. No signs of it hanging out in the Gulf and creating any type of trouble in that region. Sometimes they do that, but not this time. Another great tool, I showed this yesterday, figured I'd fire it up again today, is the total precipitable water graphic here, the TPW from University of Wisconsin site. There's the tropical wave. Look, it's got a little bit of curvature to it. Absolutely, there's some energy there. Yep, it's starting to wrap in some Saharan air layer too, and so that'll help to mitigate any further development more than likely. But that's a good deal of moisture in there that's moving in towards these islands over here, so heads up down there. I know I've got quite a few viewers, Trinidad, Tobago, and points north, Daniela up there in Antigua. just trying to remember people off the top of my head. Brent in the Virgin Islands, Tim, all sorts of folks down there. Watch out, because Matt in St. Thomas, you guys all be ready. Some heavy rain might be headed your way. And by the way, you can find this graphic over at the University of Wisconsin site. Just Google CIM, or just, I think, University of Wisconsin Tropical, and you can find it. It's the TPW, Total Precipitable Water Animation. There is the next feature, coming off the coast of Africa, a little bit of spin to it, and energy associated with it, and it's going to gather, and the ensembles are pretty enthusiastic that this will develop and move its way through the main development region and start to try to energize. And then there is the clear signal of what's trying to take shape in the eastern Pacific. It's amazing, these different tools that we've got. All right, so why all of the hoopla over what might be happening out this way? Well, first of all, you got this little bit of warming in the equatorial Pacific, and when it's a lot of warming, we call that an El Nino. And that's this abnormal warming of the equatorial Pacific. The reverse of that, the opposite, is La Nina, when it's an abnormal cooling. You also get a very similar phenomenon along the equator. There's 0 degrees latitude right through there in the Atlantic. And some people refer to this as an Atlantic Nino. And I don't know if that's a real thing, if like NOAA calls it that. I mean, anybody can call anything they want. You know, I'm not the naming police, but I don't know if that's a real thing, like in science, if there's journals written about Atlantic Nino or not. I'm not saying there isn't. I just don't know, but I haven't really looked into it deeply myself. But what is the point here, and what really matters, is that that is a pretty significant warming of the equatorial region just south of Sierra Leone and Liberia in the Gulf of Guinea region. Right along the equator there, and we're talking some of those water temperatures. If you look down at the graph here, the chart, the legend, you can tell, you know, 2 to 3 degrees Celsius warmer than average. And in fact, we can zoom in on this and take a closer look. There it is, right through there. All that extra warmth leads to more upward motion, kind of helping to draw in and make more prevalent the West African monsoon, maybe pulling the intertropical convergent zone a little bit farther to the south than normal. And all of that helps to induce these low-level westerlies onshore. And then you get in the mid-levels, low to mid-levels, easterly winds with the African easterly jet. And that helps to create this spin coming through here. And it produces these stronger tropical waves. And the water temperatures just all around this area, for the most part, are warmer than average. Just a few specks in here, very minor, of below average. Everything else is warmer, from a quarter to a half, maybe close to 1 degree Celsius through here. And that's, you know, that's enough, I guess, that we might have something develop here in the modeling. The upper ocean heat content, we'll definitely want to watch this in the coming days. Again, this one, covering most of the Atlantic Basin, the coast of Africa ends, whoops, I'm drawing. The coast of Africa is just off the shot here to the right. But look, right here, there's your northern extent of at least fairly sensible, in other words, that you can feel and detect upper ocean heat content. That water temperature is 80 degrees Fahrenheit or higher, and it's also fairly deep, enough so to get triggered in whatever algorithms there are that picks up these things on this particular graphic from NOAA and the AOML, that's the Atlantic Oceanographic Meteorological Laboratory down in Miami. Bottom line is this area is juiced at least to about 10, 11 degrees north latitude, so anything staying fairly far to the south will have enough energy to work with. So despite the fact that it's only late June and not late July or late August, there is enough energy out there, and this is why we need to pay attention. Check this out. CJ, one of our producer people, social media gurus, great guy, all-around helper, whatever, down in the southwest coast of Florida, Venice area, helping me out here, putting this graphic together. And this is it. This is what we're talking about. Look at the comparison here between the GEFS, That's the ensemble forecast system based off the GFS through the next 10 days. And then last night's EPS, the ensemble prediction system from the Euro out to 10 days. And you see what we get, the clustering, lots and lots of ensemble members from both groups of models. These two fairly reliable global models, the ensembles. Remember, we talk about that a lot. You can get one operational model. You can look at either one of them, GFS, Euro, Canadian, pick your whatever one, and people do that often. They'll take one operational, and they find a 10-day forecast that parks a Cat 4 hurricane off of Miami. They share it on social media, and everything blows up. We've seen it. We know how that works. And then how many times does it actually pan out, right? I've done similar things to that in the past, mistakenly so. You realize, yeah, that's no good. There's no message behind that. There's no pertinent information. That's not actionable. Nothing helps by sharing that. But this is helpful because the ensemble guidance is your key to the future. Because the more of these members that show something, the more reliable you can be that it might happen. But that's a big might. It's still just a forecast. It's not reality. But that's a pretty strong signal from two of the powerhouse model groups here, the ensembles especially. And so we will watch and see. And as I showed you, it has been outlined in yellow from the National Hurricane Center. So we'll keep an eye on that over the next few days. So speaking of operationals, here it is, the GFS operational model. And this is at 5,000 feet in the atmosphere, the vorticity signature that I talk about. And it's the whole Atlantic Basin. There's the west coast of Africa, eastern North America over here. Just kind of quickly outlining it so you know what's what. And then we will be watching mainly this little rectangle down in the deep tropics. All right, so let's put this into motion, kind of one frame at a time, see what happens. First, the easterly wave energy right there at about 42 to 48 hours starts to move into the windwards and leewards. So again, be mindful of that. There's those westerly winds. See those wind barbs right there? And everything's kind of converging on shore on the west and south part. And then coming in from the east here, you've got easterlies this way. So all of that right there, I'll just kind of draw it in, gives you this spin, cyclonic motion of that energy coming off of Africa. And then there's our system trying to take shape south of the Mexican coastline. And look, there's a little impulse there in the Yucatan Channel, maybe some disturbed weather that could get mentioned by the National Hurricane Center. You never know. Boaters out there. People got to pay attention to that. Again, it's not just about the hurricanes, although those do get the headlines. I get it. So let's keep on going. 48 to 72 hours. Now we have a bona fide tropical cyclone in the Pacific. No doubt about it there. That is one heck of a signature. What's the date? June 26th. I mean, wow, that far east, just south of the Cabo Verde Islands, Cape Verde Islands, however you want to pronounce it. Wow, that really is eye-opening. And this has got to be watched, too, this little feature here. And then the other tropical wave moving through the Greater Antilles and into the Caribbean without much fanfare. But still, heavy rain, gusty winds locally, yep, that could be a problem. Finally, at 96 hours, probably a hurricane here off the coast of Mexico, not too far from Manzanillo, but still offshore enough, hopefully. And then this is trying to get energized out in the open tropical Atlantic, going against the odds, though. And I mean, the odds are against it, honestly. The Saharan air layer, climatology, all that. We typically don't see development that far east, and there's a reason for that. And we'll watch this in the Gulf. Could be an impulse headed towards the Texas coastline with more heavy rain in that area, where you quite frankly don't need it. Finally, at day five, not much really going on. This system looks to maybe at this point try to bypass Mexico. We'll see. Maybe it ends up like I talked about, farther to the north. What's good for the desert southwest and northwest Mexico, the desert area, the Sonoran, could be bad for the Cabo San Lucas region. We'll watch that. But boy, you can take the moisture pretty much any way you can get it. There's the tropical wave in the deep central Atlantic. There's another one coming off. Wow, it is going to be a long and pretty busy hurricane season, it does appear. This is all the way out to June 28th, but it's still just June 28th. So real quick, looking at the system in the Pacific, it winds up, and let's just run this out and see where it goes from here, kind of dies off before ever making landfall, as you can see there. And yes, I do see the little system way out in time. That's 204 hours. So, you know, I'll just scribble this out. No, look at that. This is way out in time. It's not believable. I want to see what's going on with our cyclone here in the Pacific, because recently these models were trying to bring it up into Mexico. So I have to wait and see what happens with that. Our friends down along the Mexican coastline, you know, it matters. So let's see what happens with this. That's 96, 120. Let's just go out to 168. That's a week out right there. And it still stays far enough offshore, but maybe some of that moisture can get drawn up. I'm probably reaching there, but boy, they really need it. And yes, a week out, we do need to watch that. Possibly trying to congeal and come together somewhere in the Gulf. Why not? It's hurricane season. It would be expected to happen, and no surprise. So we'll watch it. We'll see what's going on. I'll talk about it here every morning, at least, you know, for the foreseeable future through November anyway. Hurricane Season, the podcast. That is my morning briefing. Much, much shorter than these video discussions for obvious reasons. I don't have anything to show you. It's just a little morning digest of what I'm keeping an eye on for the coming day. And it's available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, pretty much anywhere you can get your podcast, hosted by Anchor. And it's totally ad-free, doesn't cost anything. You subscribe to it, get the RSS feed, all that good stuff, and you can listen to it very quick, usually 3, 4, 5 minutes of, you know, what I'm looking at for the day ahead. And then when we get to this, we go into much more detail on the hurricane outlook and discussion. All right, well, there you have it. That is it from me for today. Lots to keep up with. I'll be back with more tomorrow, starting with the morning podcast, and then we'll take it from there. As always, thanks for tuning in from whatever device you happen to be listening and watching from. I do appreciate your time and attention. I am Mark Suddeth, HurricaneTrack.com. We'll talk again tomorrow.